Edith Goodenough isn't in the country anymore. She's in town now, in the hospital. Lying there on that white bed, a needle stuck in the back of one hand. And a man standing guard out in the hallway. She will be 80 years old this week. A beautiful white-haired woman who has been thin and frail since New Year's Eve. Still, the sheriff and the lawyers think she'll be well enough for them to sit her up in a wheelchair and then take her across town to the courthouse to begin the trial. Bud Seeley, the sheriff, has turned out to be a son of a bitch. But I still can't see him putting handcuffs on a woman like Edith Goodenough. About 9 days ago, Bud Seeley was sitting on a stool at the Hope Cafe. Friday afternoon, about 2:30, slap. He finished filling out his paperwork. Nothing to do but wait until the high school kids got out of school so they could start racing up and down Main Street or out US 34. He had time. He had finished eating his butterscotch pie and was waiting for his second cup of coffee when someone nobody knew came into the cafe. Reporter from Denver. A little after 2:30 on Friday in April. April 2:30. That was the date and time that Bud Seeley started seriously to become a son of a bitch. Took that reporter out to his cop car and they drove off up Main Street. Showed him the 50-pound bag of chicken feed that had been sliced open and laid just inside the coop where it wouldn't get wet. Then they went off up a residential street, Birch or Cedar, and he let him have a look at the old milky-eyed dog that had been tied up that particular December afternoon 3 months ago, tied up, but still within reach of several days' food and water. Now, I can't say what Bud was thinking. Maybe seeing his name appear on the front of a Denver newspaper. Maybe he thought we'd be proud of him and we'd put an X next to his name come the first Tuesday in November. And then he'd just go on making those tuition payments to the State University in Boulder, where it looked like his kid was never going to amount to a goddamn. Or even graduate. Can't say. All I know is that cop car was still out there and he and the Denver reporter still in it, still talking, still licking up to each other like a couple of dogs. It was then and there, with corn stubble on one side of the road and green wheat on the other, that Bud Seeley emptied himself. He gave up Edith Goodenough. And 8 days ago, Saturday, I'm doctoring cows. I hear the tires on the gravel grind. I see the Denver plates. I see the Denver Post reporter. Mr. Roscoe, he says, I'm with the Denver Post. Maybe you've heard of it. Sure, I say, I've heard of it. We keep it on the back porch when we scrape our boots so we don't have to track cow into the kitchen.
He doesn't think that's funny.
Well, Mr. Roscoe, they say you know all the neighbors around here, Edith and Lyman Goodenough, for instance. They say you knew them better than anybody. So there it is.
I say,
didn't all these people you talk to at least tell you how to say their name? Goodenough. It's Goodenough. He has a little ever-sharp pencil and a little notepad, and we're standing there on top of cow manure. Then he says, you do admit that it was deliberate, don't you? You want to know what I think? I say, I think it's none of your goddamn business. I take a step toward him and I say, mister, get yourself off my place and don't you ever come back. Then he goes. And well, it got in the papers anyway. They put it on the front page.
They put my picture over here on the left and Lyman's picture opposite over there on the right, with both of us staring into the middle, so that it seemed that we were not only looking at one another, but studying what was between us, the writing there, like the writing on the inside cover of a family Bible. Roy Goodenough, born Cedar County, Iowa, 1870. Ada Twombly, born Johnson County, Iowa, 1872. Ada Twombly Goodenough dies, 1988. 1914. Roy Goodenough dies 1952.
And finally, below that date, there was one more date, that last one. The one that was the reason for there even being an article in the newspaper. Friday, December 31st, 1976. So that much that Denver reporter found out. That wasn't all of it. Bud Seeley had told him about the chickens and the old dog and Lyman asleep on his cot. But the story left out Roy's stumps and Lyman's Pontiacs and postcards. Nobody told that reporter that. I would have been the one to tell it, but by God, I would not. Because listen, if a person wanted to sit down quiet, not wanting to print this all up in some damn newspaper with pictures looking at what's printed between them like it's something to be ashamed of, if a person wanted to sit down quiet in a chair Sunday afternoon, if a person did not want to rush me, well, then I could tell it. And I would tell it so that it would be all. And I would tell it so that it would be right. Most of what I'm going to tell you, I know. The rest of it, I believe. I would begin with Edith's parents, Roy Goodenough and Ada Twombly Goodenough, and her brother Lyman, because, listen,
our father, Roy Goodenough, married late. He was 25 when Ada Twombly married him.
Our mother, Ada, married late for a woman. She was 23. In pictures, you can see that she was small and thin, with eyes too big for her head, blue veins showing at both temples. She was tight-struck, nervous, too fine altogether for what he wanted. She said once she never should have married somebody like him. He was a hard stick, string arms and legs, with an Adam's apple, a hickory nut, that jugged up and down, mule-headed.
Well, our father, Roy, he saw the flyers, government brochures, acres of land left if a man could improve on some of it, stay on it, on those cold, wet Iowa nights in the first winter of their marriage. He stood beside a kerosene lamp. He read those flyers and government brochures till he had them by heart.
And our mother Ada was lying there, thin and straight in their bed under some thick homemade quilts. Lying there, she waited for him with her hair already combed out and braided, trying to stay awake, waiting for him.
And he just went on, standing there beside that foul smoking lamp, reading and planning and shivering from the long sagbut underwear, his red feet itching from the cold, and his arms and legs gone to goosebumps and pig's bristle.
Ada, not sleeping yet.
Ada, just knowing he would wake her so he could tell her once more how, by God, he had it all figured out.
Roy and Ada Goodenough left Iowa in a loaded wagon and moved to the high plains of Colorado. They didn't make much more than 20 miles a day. They came alone. And when they got here, what did they find? That happens to be one of the things I know. If they expected deep black topsoil and 40 inches of annual rainfall and good drainage and plenty of hardwood close by, bur oak and black walnut for lumber and for fuel, they never should have thrown any bag of seeds or plow or foot pedal sewing machine into any wagon.
There were almost no trees.
This country was sandy, dry, and for the most part just flat, with only a few low sand hills running off to the Nebraska Panhandle.
Even now there are not many trees. Although some people have trees that were planted 60 or 70 years ago. Some people have trees standing up around their houses, and you can tell where someone lives or used to live because of those trees.
I don't believe Ada ever got over the shock of it. A flat, treeless, dry place that once belonged to the Indians. Hell of a big piece of sandy country with a horizon that in all directions must have seemed then to reach forever away. Under a summer sun that didn't give much of a good goddamn whether or not the seeds Roy was going to plant in the sand ever developed into a piddly thing.
There was just too much of it, and none of it looked like Iowa.
Roy picked a quarter section of grass a half mile east of another house where a six-year-old boy lived with his mother, a pipe-smoking Indian woman, and they lasted. Roy filed his claim, put his horses to pulling a sod-busting plow, planted his bag of Iowa corn, into the rough ground, bought a cow or two, and then finally put up a frame house for Ada.
Our mother Ada had been living under a tarp till then. A tarp tied to the side of a wagon, living like a nomad Arab, cooking over an open fire, coaxing beans and peas and a couple of zinnias to grow in a corner of the summer. No water to take back. Walked half a mile with yoked pails across her shoulders to fetch water from where the Indian woman lived. She took two baths that summer at the Indian woman's house. She did not tell Roy.
Roy's dryland corn didn't do very well that first year. There was too much sagebrush and soapweed.
And by corn harvest, our mother Ada was good and sick.
Sometime in August of that summer, Roy found enough sap and energy and time to get her pregnant. He was going to do that birthing thing himself, too. He was going to boil the sheets, rotate the head, slap some breath into the baby, and then sew Ada up afterwards with needle and thread, without help from anyone. Government brochures.
By the night of April 21st, Ada had been in labor for 3 days. Her brown hair stuck to her face, her thighs gone rigid as sticks.
Roy took a workhorse, galloped the half mile west, woke the half Indian woman. God damn it, I can do it! He yelled at her in the darkness. But she wants you, she wants you! The half Indian woman came and she must have made some tea, or maybe it was her voice and hand. But anyway, she delivered the baby girl. Afterwards, she must have made a couple of things plain enough that even Roy understood. Because 2 years later, in June, when again it was Ada's time, Roy didn't wait until his wife had been in labor for 3 days before he decided it was time for him to start howling in the dark.
So Lyman's birth went easier without the galloping horse and the yelling. This was 1899. Roy had a boy and a girl. He didn't expect much of the girl.
I was the potato peeler, the egg gatherer.
Roy said he wasn't real thrilled with the way the boy, Lyman, turned out. He said Lyman worked in a loose, mechanical fashion.
I sure as hell didn't leave the farm very often. I just didn't like any of it.
Roy said Lyman was a lapdog. Well, sir, Roy Goodenough had a boy and a girl to help now. Well, he was frugal enough. He could do things like go on tying his machinery together with baling wire, patching it up as best he could, rather than buy something new.
We grew up out here 7 miles from home. As kids, Lyman and I, we slept together in a double straw tick bed in one of the upstairs bedrooms, wrapping our legs around one another to keep warm.
We told ourselves stories about what we were going to do when we were big enough and free enough of the farm and our father to do great things.
Well, we never did them. But during the days when we were kids, in the few hours left,
when we weren't hoeing beans or milking cows or churning butter or shoveling shit out of the milk barn window,
we played games behind haystacks and deep and tall cornfields. And in 1903, I started riding 3 miles to the converted chicken house school with the two-hole privy, riding one of the played-out workhorses whose back was so broad that my legs stuck straight out. The boy, John Roscoe, down the road was in his 7th and next to last year. He was a help to me.
I know they rode to school together. John Roscoe, the 13-year-old boy who would be my father, with the stiff black hair, and the 6-year-old girl Edith in high-topped shoes that had been her mother's. He protected her during lunch, and the kids sang, "Johnny has a sweetheart, ain't she sweet?" Because I believe that was when and where what happened later, 19 years later, started just that much. Then he finished the 8th grade, and for a while, John Roscoe, the son of the half-Indian woman, and Edith Goodenough didn't see much of each other except during harvest.
When I was old enough to start school, Edith and I rode double on the workhorse. I only went 4 of the 5 years. Edith never finished the 8th grade.
Roy wouldn't allow it. Said it was a waste of time.
In the pictures taken of Edith and Lyman between 1899 and 1914, Edith is a beautiful girl with her mother's big eyes and enough of her father in her to make her stand straight up and face the camera head on. In one picture, Edith has her arm around Lyman, who stands as if tucked into the folds of her long skirt like some kind of wet-combed copper spaniel. And Ada, in the album, Ada seems to be sinking down, and picture after picture she looks smaller, thinner. Her cheeks suck into the bone, her hair turns sparse gray. By 1913, in the last picture of her, she stands barely as tall as Roy's shoulder. The only thing you can make out of her face in the grainy photograph are her big eyes, looking not at whoever it was who held the camera, but away, off towards something in the distance.
In 1914, August, the hottest month of the year in Holt, she got sick. They say it was the flu, but I believe it was more than just some virus bug that got her. I believe it was all those years of looking east.
It was all those years of being married to Roy.
Once, when her own mother died, she had gone back to Johnson County on the train, and she stayed so long after the funeral that Roy had to go out and bring her back. Now she lay up there in that second-story bedroom, sweating and burning up. She was weak as water.
She didn't make much of a bump under the sweat-soaked sheets.
The second or third day, she told Roy, "I want her now. I want her to come." And when she seemed worse, when the sun was hottest, Roy drove the half mile to get the pipe-smoking Indian woman, an old woman now, but her eyes were still clear and black. Mother fumbled her hand out of the bedsheet, thanked her for coming. I smoothed the bone-thin, yellowing forehead with a cool washcloth. Lyman went on staring at our mother from his place against the wall, like he was rooted there, like he didn't dare do anything else but stand and stare. Mother slept for several hours that way with her hand held loosely by the other woman.
At six, as we had some dinner, Roy said, "Lyman, you didn't tell me that red-faced cow was going dry." I said, "What?" Roy said, "That cow's damn near dry. You never told me." I said, "I forgot." Roy said, "What else have you forgot?" I said, "Nothing. I don't know."
Gradually, it grew darker in her room. The lamplight cast shadows, and then the millers, those small, dusty moths, came out of the cracks in the wall.
One of the millers landed on Ada's forehead and left its smudge of dust.
I brushed it off. Our mother seemed to rouse for a moment, and our mother said, "You make him. Tell him." "What?" I asked. And she said, "I want him to take me to Johnson County. I want to sleep beside my mother. You make him. You tell him." She said that. "You make him." She didn't say anything more. Sometime before midnight, she died. We couldn't tell for sure when she stopped breathing. Her breath was so soft at the last. By lamplight, I washed the child-sized body, combed out her hair, and put on the Sunday dress.
The next day, Roy Goodnow buried her in the Holt County Cemetery, northeast of town.
At the gravesite, I said to him, "You know what Mother wanted. You were there." And he said, "No, she was sick then." I said, "You heard her say so." He said, "I want her here." "Mother didn't like it here," I told him. "She hated it. This wasn't her home."
Roy told her, "Your mother's dead. You're the mother now."
"What do you mean? I can't replace Mother."
And Roy said, "You will."
Ada's was the first of three Goodnow graves that have been dug so far, over there in the brown grass beside the fence. Ada lived to be 42. Edith was 17 when her mother died. Lyman was 15. They were both a year older when the next thing happened that fixed it for them. It wasn't enough that their father was Roy Goodnow or that their mother died early. No, sir, there had to be one more thing to clinch matters, to fix them forever, to make Edith and Lyman end up the way they did. Two old people, a sister and a brother, living alone out here in in a yellow house surrounded by weeds. It was during harvest, and Roy Goodenow must have hated harvest time.
No, that's not quite right. Like the rest of us, he loved it too, because it meant the end. It meant the accomplishment of what had started months before with plowed sand and bags of seed.
But Roy worried about it, stewed in his juice about it, stepped out the first thing in the morning, even before he had his pants buttoned good.
He had to search the sky for clouds in the hope now that it wouldn't rain, or worse, that if there were clouds, that he could detect no sickly green, because that kind of green in clouds meant hail.
At harvest time, Roy had to ask someone for help.
I drove a team of horses pulling the header barge.
I leveled the wheat off in the back of the barge.
I cooked breakfast and washed dishes, and I went out and helped Roy at the grindstone, holding the long sickle bar while he sat on the narrow iron seat, pumping the foot pedals of the grindstone. He ground the edges that had been nicked by rocks and ground them down smooth so they shone like just honed knife blades. And as he ground the blades, he talked to Lyman.
Royce, you turned the cows out?
Yes.
Royce, did you put a cloth over the milk cans?
Yes.
Royce, there was a gob of flies dunking in it yesterday.
I know, I couldn't find the cover cloth.
Royce, we wouldn't need no cloth if you hadn't lost the goddamn lids. But you never looked for the cloth either, did you? And it was hanging on the nail in the kitchen.
Roy still needed one more person to stack the wheat once the barge was full. So he asked John Roscoe, my father, who lived down the road. My father, John Roscoe, was 25 in 1915. It was a Thursday morning late in July. Roy had the sickle bar slid into the front of the header and bolted in place so that the section blades could move back and forth, cutting off the wheat close to the ground. Lyman walked six horses up to the back of the header. Edith hitched two more horses to the wagon, to the header barge, and we rode rattling out of the yard towards the wheat field.
When we entered the field, I could see John Roscoe standing on the stack over in the corner.
Roy said, I suppose Roscoe's been waiting there for an hour without a goddamn thing in the world to do except wait on us. It ain't hot enough. He wants to get burned. He thinks fried skin looks pretty.
The six horses moved, lunged forward, pushing the heavy, rattling header. The engaged gears and chains turned the reel at the front that came round and laid the wheat down under the sickle bar to be cut off by the slicing, knife-sharp sections.
As the wheat was cut, it fell onto a platform beneath the rotating reel.
And then it was carried by a canvas belt off to the side and up another canvas belt through a chute and out, falling into the header barge that I drove alongside.
I was in the back of the barge where the cut wheat on its dusty stalks fell around me, made me itch and sweat and scratch. By Jesus, it scratched. Hog shit in the bucket!
It worked that way through the morning. The July sun rose higher and hotter in the sky, and the dust hung in the air like a ton of gnats. Roy sat up there hard in his seat at the back of the header, with horses on either side of him. The horses were dark with sweat along their necks and shoulders where the collars rode.
White foam, like soap lather, worked in between the big muscles.
Flies bothered their eyes and underbellies.
I wore my thin work dress and flat-brimmed straw hat. I clucked to my horses from my seat at the front of the barge in the morning heat. Occasionally, I looked up at John Roscoe across the field on a lead stack. His bare back shone in the morning heat. I shredded several heads of wheat and chewed on the hard kernels to make wheat gum. I rocked on the wood seat, watching the rumps of the horses rise and fall ahead of me.
At noon, we stopped. I unhitched the horses at Roy's command. I led the horses along the fence to the water tank. When they stopped drinking, the horses began to sniff at the water and to raise their heads to look around them with dark eyes, sighing and shuddering a little like horses do when they've been worked hard and seem to look off away towards something you yourself do not see, cannot see.
Lyman held his head under the water pipe, and then dripping water from his head and shoulders down into his pants, led the horses back to where Edith and John Roscoe sat in the shade.
For our lunch, I had brought fresh peas and beans, salt pork, and thick slices of bread, cold boiled potatoes, and Dutch apple pie. We drank buttermilk in tin cups.
For a while, as Roy worked with the horses, Edith and John Roscoe and I lay down with our straw hats over our faces.
Louis Feister and his crew going to thresh for you again this year?
I don't know. Pa don't tell us nothing one way or another.
He is. I wrote the letter to him in Kansas.
I thought Ludie and your dad had a little bit of an argument last year.
Oh, they did. Ludie thought that we hadn't sweat enough, too wet to thresh. Ludie said, Pa said, thresh it anyhow.
The sun speckled through the weave of their hats. Lyman lay between Edith and John Roscoe, the wet back of his shirt and overalls caked with sand.
We could smell the cut wheat, dusty and heavy in the air.
Lyman went to sleep, breathing slow, regularly, like a small boy. I believe Edith and my father must have stayed awake together, thinking about one another across Lyman's overalls. No, I would have. Then the horses had finished eating, you understand. The horses were rested. The gears and chains had been oiled. Roy was back up on his seat at the back of the header, sitting ramrod still in the sun, the reel in front of him turning in the sharp section blades along the sickle bar, cutting off the wheat close to the ground, then the canvas belts carrying the wheat off and up through the chute to fall into the header barge that Edith drove alongside. My father stayed on the stack, forking the wheat level and even. I believe they would have finished, too. I believe if everything I remember about that afternoon is everything I was told about it, that they would have finished cutting that field of wheat before dark. And then all Roy Goodnow would have had to do was to let it sit in the stack sweating for a couple of months till it was dry enough for Ludie Feister to come along and thresh it. But late in the afternoon, long about 5 o'clock, the header stopped working. It jolted, lurched. Roy saw it at the lines to the horses. God damn it, he said, back up!
The horses stood there, nervous, high-strung, hot, bothered by flies. Roy climbed down to see what had happened.
They were next to the barbed wire fence, so maybe that's where they picked up the wire. Or maybe a piece of the heavy wire that Roy always used to tie his machinery together with finally broke off and fell into the teeth of the section blades. He had wire stuck hard between two teeth. The whole business was stopped dead from cutting wheat. He blamed Lyman, he blamed my father. You, Lyman, Roy said. God damn you! The horses lunged forward, pushing the header toward Roy, where he stood in front of them. Roy said, whoa, god damn it, stop now! Lyman, you and that damn Roscoe can't even fix a goddamn fence without you gotta spread wire all over goddamn hell. I told you to help Roscoe fix that fence for helping me last year, but that don't mean you gotta spread wire all over a man's wheat field, does it?
It's not Lyman's fault. You know it isn't, and it's not John Roscoe's.
You shut up, Roy said. You stay out of this. Well, now I got Roscoe's wire stuck in my header, goddamn sons of bitchin' kids. It might just as well have been Roy's own wire stopping the teeth. The wire he always used to tie his damn machinery together with rather than buy something new or even forking out the 2 cents that would buy the bolt that would fix it. Roy bent down in front of the header under the wood bats, began to pull at the wire with both hands, working it back and forth to try to get it free somehow.
He started on the other piece of heavy wire, bending it back and forth, but it wouldn't come. And he went a little insane with the heat and the stale sweat pouring into his eyes.
And the wire wasn't coming. He pulled at it, sawed at it.
He went on bending it, sawing at it viciously. Then it came so suddenly, snapped so fast, that he stood up too quick and banged his head hard against the reel back.
God damn it, Roy shouted. God damn it to hell. And that's what did it. The hot, angry voice he hardly ever used except to tell someone what to do or to curse you with, to damn you. voice he didn't know how to use in any way that was kind at all. His own angry, insane voice fixed you.
Because, you understand, the horses were hot.
The horses were high-strung, nervous, jittery now from this yelling at him and from his sawing at the lines.
Because they were used to being started by his yelling, and they couldn't anyway distinguish from his giddy-up to his goddamn.
And it was his goddamn he yelled.
Goddamn it to him!
And the horses lunged forward. The six workhorses threw themselves hard into the harness. And the header moved, jolted forward.
It was free of wire now.
The long bat of the reel came round and hit him hard. A blow to the nape of the neck had dropped him to his hands and knees.
He braced his fall, but his fingers were stuck in the sharp blades of the sections. He had honed them that morning himself on the grindstone. They were knife sharp.
And now his fingers were in them between the bright blades. His fingers were being mangled.
And all the while he was yelling, cursing, screaming, his feet kicking out wild behind him.
And the header kept moving forward, Edith and me running alongside, yelling at the horses. The horses still lunging at the harness, shoving the header at him, carrying him forward with it, cutting wheat with his fingers.
The backs of the reel cracking him down again and again, the wheat being cut all around him, and his fingers in the section blades being cut, sliced, hacked.
Then it was over that fast. It was over. He was torn free of his fingers and carried off to the side by the canvas belt.
We got the horses stopped.
John Roscoe had seen what was happening. He jumped down from the sack and came running.
I helped Father crawl out of the header. It was bad. He had one long open cut above his eyes and another in the hair at the back of his head.
He was all covered with blood and wheat chaff.
But it was his hands that frightened me. He held them out in front of him, out away from his body, as if they were exhibits.
His hands were gore now. Raw meat, hamburger. All the fingers and thumb on his right hand were gone. Chopped off.
The thumb and first three fingers of his left hand were gone too. Leaving only the little finger alone on that hand, alone of all his fingers uncut. The little finger of his left hand didn't have a scratch on it. It was like a mockery.
He held his hands out in front of him, staring at the ruined stumps as they throbbed blood dripping down off the jagged stumps into the wheat stubble. Oh, God, Daddy, oh, God, come on, though.
Roy seemed to almost wake up to come out of his wild daze. His fingers were gone. He kept yelling, I ain't leaving, I ain't leaving. They're mine.
What? No! Come on, we've got to hurry!
I ain't leaving them here! They're mine! They ain't yours, are they? They ain't yours!
Please! No! Oh, God! Help me, John!
John Roscoe took Roy by the hand and tried to get him to move towards the road, but Roy pulled his bloody arm free. They're mine, goddammit! They ain't yours! I told you! Yes, you told us, my father said. They ain't yours! They're mine! Get them for me! I want them all! My father said, we'll find them, and then... Lyman, get my car started.
Oh, Jesus, I turned and ran, stumbling across the wheat stubble. I fell, I jumped up again and ran.
Roy Goodenough's hands and arms were twitching uncontrollably now, dripping blood all the time.
He held those hands out in front of him. Blood was pouring down his face and more blood running down the back of his head. He's going to die.
No, he isn't, not yet.
I'm afraid he's going to die, though.
My father said, Edith, you stay here with him. I'll look and see if I can find any of his fingers. Jesus! Christ Almighty. And Roy was screaming, I want them. They're mine. They ain't yours.
Yes, Daddy, hush now.
And Roy said, I want them.
Yes, I know.
They're mine, Roy said.
Daddy, please be quiet.
And Roy kept screaming, they're mine, they're mine. And then my father found two of the fingers and one of the thumbs. The thumb was still stuck in the section blades. He couldn't find any more.
I held them in my lap on the way into town. Riding in the back seat of our Model T Ford with Lyman.
The fingers looked like thick, bloody sausages, except that they had black hair between what would have been knuckles, and they had fingernails on the ends.
There was still dirt under the fingernails. I brushed the sand and wheat chaff off.
Roy sat in front, his head dropped onto his chest. He mumbled, I told you, didn't I?
John Roscoe sent me to find Doc Parker in the back room of his office. They cut Roy's shirt and long underwear off. He sat there in his ripped pants, dripping blood into a bucket. They put him on a table, his arms out to his side.
I reached into my pocket and I pulled out the handkerchief. I handed it to Doc Parker. He had to have them, I told him. He wouldn't leave without them. Doc Parker looked at me. He said, Edith, you wasted your time. He shook off the handkerchief into one of the buckets.
I ain't no Jesus Christ, the doctor said. Hold him still now. This is gonna hurt.
In the end, about all Doc Parker could do was to trim the stumps of Roy's fingers and thumbs a little bit. Then he stretched the ragged flaps of skin over the ends and stitched them up into hard welts. Roy Goodenough probably should have died, but he didn't. 37 years with those cruel, raw-looking hands.
He could crook his arms under a bucket or hold a fence post while someone tapped in around it.
He learned to push a button through its hole so he could get his shirt on using that one little finger.
But he couldn't milk a cow, or work a fence pliers, or drive a tractor.
He was fixed. He was dependent on other people, and he hated it. But if their father was fixed, Edith and Lyman were fixed even worse. They were stuck now on that sandhill farm. They couldn't leave him, not that way. It was hell for all of them. They were all fixed. If Edith and Lyman had been city kids, things might have been different. City kids, even in 1915, had some opportunities for escape, walking 10 or 12 blocks, or hop on a trolley headed across town and end up far from home. Or if Edith and Lyman had been country kids, living now, alive and howling in the 1970s, things might have been different. It's all high school and 3-2 beer and loud music and fast cars racing up and down Main Street on Saturday night, honking and howling. But Edith and Lyman didn't have those things. They were farm kids in the second decade of this violent century, and they were stuck. They had Roy Goodenough, and they seen him get his hands ruined. So I don't mean they were stuck just a little bit, no. I mean they were deep stuck.
I did the cooking, and the cleaning, and the mending, and the washing clothes, and the ironing. I managed the garden. I planted, hoed, watered, canned, and pickled. I carried wood, fed chickens, and milked. I went to the barn, set the head catch to hold the cows there. I hitched up my skirt and threw hay down into the manger. I set the T-shaped milk stool into place, and I sat down, with my head close to the cow's leg to keep from getting hit in the face too much by the stinging, eye-blinding tail. I washed off her tits with a wet rag, pulled the first squirts of milk from each tit to clean them, check for mastitis. I squeezed the bucket between my legs and milked the cow out enough to leave some for the calf to suck on and survive. And then I did the same thing with the next cow and the next cow and the next cow and the next, talking to them quietly, calming them down.
Sometimes I'm sure. Sometimes a cow kicked the bucket over. Sometimes a shit-filled tail snapped into her eyes or her mouth. But you don't know what that is. You haven't experienced the full benefit of stink and outrage until you've had a fresh cow, an old raw-boned bitch of a cow you hate anyway, come in to be milked for the first time after having a calf. And when she gets in, she has a 3-day-old afterbirth hanging down out because she hasn't cleaned out right. And there it is, swinging between her back legs, juicy, buzzing with flies, and the rottenness of it is so putrid, so goddamn awful. But you sit yourself down on the milk stool and you pray or cross your fingers if only you can get her milk without having to taste any of that putrid foulness. Yes, that's right. Easy. Now, easy, Mama. And Jesus. Just about got it knocked out enough to call it good. When bang, holy shit, she hits you with all of it, all of that shit and juice and outrage right across your face, and it covers your eyes, your nose, your mouth, and oh, brother, help me, son of a bitch! Well, it happened to me once. And once is enough.
I spent all my brain and muscle and all my sweat planting the same corn rows year after year, cultivating and hand-picking, planting the same wheat field, disking and harvesting. I stacked the same hay fields and stacked the same hay stacks.
Roy saw all of this, of course, treating Lyman like some kind of ass-whipped mongrel dog he kept at heel on a short chain. Lyman worked that sandhill farming, but all he could manage to do was to wait and hope in his dog-eyed, dazed fashion that someday, somehow, some kind of pasture gate would get left open just enough for him to squeeze through it. 7 years, then it was 1922. Edith was 25. In the summer of 1922, she must have been slim and quick, brown-eyed, woman-breasted. She was quiet and focused. She made me want to hold her there in the front seat of that car on that country road. Hold her, put your arm around her, kiss her, breathe her hair. Tell her those things you hadn't told anyone else before, things you didn't know for sure you felt or thought until you heard yourself telling them to her in the dark, in that stopped car, because somehow it would be all right if she heard them, and they would be true then. You see, Edith and my father, John Roscoe, went out together that summer. For 6 or 7 months, they went out spooning, or whatever it was called back then. Two people in a Ford car, windows rolled down, dark air blowing in on them, turning towards each other now and then.
We went to dances, to the next town over for a movie. Mainly, though, we drove the country roads and the sandhills in John Roscoe's old Ford. It was enough to be together and be moving.
Almost always. I rode with them in the back seat.
Maybe that's the reason Roy let them go. I suppose he thought Lyman would put a halt to any funny stuff. Lyman was always somewhere, waiting like a kind of dog, stray dog, to see what developed. My dad was 32 then, tough, black-haired, the kind of man that dogs and horses come up to for a scratch without his ever having a whistle. Every fall, he was still there helping the good nose, watching Edith, talking with her, some joking with Lyman. When my mother, his mother rather, my grandmother died, he buried her on the rise north of the barn. Edith was the only person there. My father told Edith that his own mother never had anything, just him, a 6-year-old kid. He said his father just left her out there with him, a cow and one horse. Son of a bitch, my father said. I don't know how she stood it.
And I told John Roscoe, some people can't. They can't. But she could, though.
Maybe that's what my father was waiting for. For Edith Goodenough to suggest some kindness for his mother. Anyway, they began going out together in his Ford car with Lyman in the back seat. And it was summer, end of summer, after one of those nights in town at the picture show, after a dish of ice cream, that what started right ended wrong.
Lyman was asleep in the back seat. When we got to the corner where we had to turn east to go home, we woke him. And I asked if he could do me a favor, if he would walk the rest of the way, not quite home, and wait for me so we could walk in together.
What if Pa finds out?
He won't. Take my coat and lay on the grass.
What if he does?
Well, I don't know. Will you do it?
But don't forget to pick me up.
Oh, we won't. Thank you, Lyman. But don't you want my coat?
Oh, no. Lay on it yourself. It better not take very long. That's all I know.
And then they were alone. And on both sides of them, all those sunflowers and all that sage and soapweed and blue gramma grass. I don't know if they had a moon, but I hope they did. Because Edith Goodenough deserved to be seen in that pale blue light at least once in her life. I know they had high stars. And my dad must have held her then, kissed her. Not the chin-bumping kind of kiss, but the kind where you learn to make a good mixture of your mouth with hers and you both want more. So he must have kissed her, been kissed. And truth to tell, I hope they got out of the car then. I'm going to believe they did. Believe that they stood there in that blue quiet and then walked away until they found a hollow in the grass, laid down on his coat and talked quietly, almost in a whisper. while he unbuttoned her soft blouse. And she watched his eyes, and his eyes told that he realized he was being given a gift. And all the time on her part, she wasn't afraid of anything, just waiting and watching him, his dark eyes. And then she had one hand warm on his neck and the other hand in his black hair. And I'm going to believe it was as beautiful as sometimes it can be.
What's going to happen to this job?
Why, we're going to get married. We'll have a fine time.
Well, I don't know that at all.
I'm asking you, though, right now. You know I want us to be married.
But how can I? I mean, there's Lyman.
He's old enough. He's 24. He's old enough to manage by himself.
23. June 6th. But it's not age. It's him. It's the way he is. And it's Daddy. Don't you understand?
I don't want to think about Roy Goodenough. He's a dried-up son of a bitch.
It's just, I have to take these things into my own hands. Since Mother died 8 years ago in August, these things and these people are mine now. I've taken them up. That's all there is.
So my father, lying there in Sandhill grass, watching her while she talked while the light shone pale on her face, I suspect my father knew he couldn't win. All right, hell then, he said, if he has to, Lyman can come live with us. I'll cut him another hole in the outhouse. He'll even have his own Sears Roebuck catalog, too. He'll be as happy as a dead sow in clover. And Edith must have laughed as she reached up to feel about her hair to see that she had all the grass combed out. Lyman.
Roy was sitting at the kitchen table in his work pants and long underwear, his raw hands with one good finger resting on the white enameled wood in front of him. And now, Edith, you're done with that. That's enough for Roscoe. I've seen him stop the car. I've seen the lights on the road go off and come on again. That's done with.
I'm 25, and John's 32.
That don't mean a goddamn diddle. He's a half-breed bastard, and you're done with him. And you're his whore. Now get to bed. You must be all wore out after tonight.
No, shut up. You don't know what you're talking about.
I said you don't tell me to shut up. I'm your father. I'll say any goddamn thing I please. I told you to go to bed. Now go. This is my house. I built it. I'll say anything I want in these rooms.
It's my house, too. And it's Lyman's, and it was Mother's before she died.
She hit the damn sight of you. You're done with this now, you hear me? Goddamn sow to a Roscoe. You're done. You're through. You whore. You hear me?
The next day, Roy Goodenough kicked the chopping block and old sawed-off elm stump over with his boot, and then rolled it, pushing it with the heels of his hands across the yard into the barn.
He righted it again under a crossbeam in the center of the barn. He looped a hemp rope across the crossbeam and tied a full-handled axe to the rope so that the axe would fall and cut deep into the block. He experimented twice, pulling the axe up almost to the crossbeam to give it enough weight to do what he wanted it to do when it fell.
He pulled it up one more time, clamped the rope tight between his right elbow and his rib cage. The axe hung ready above him in the dusty, horseshit air.
And did it stop? No longer swinging. Roy laid his one finger down on the block and released the rope.
The axe fell, thunking through his finger into the block, chopping through the top knuckle of his hand, splintering it badly as it chopped through bone and joint and gristle.
He pinched up the twitching finger from the block like it was a chicken head. He pinched it up between his two arm stumps and carried the bloody thing into the house, to the kitchen.
He dropped it in the bowl of snap beans on the table in front of Edith.
I didn't move. I didn't speak. The finger bled a little among the beans. I looked up from the bowl to my father. Well, you might have saved yourself the trouble. I decided last night I couldn't leave this house. So now I'll get the bandage box and pour alcohol over the hand, and I'll wrap it to stop the bleeding. You'll probably get infection. And you should probably go see Doc Parker. But I'm not gonna go with you. I've been there once. And I just want you to know that I might have married John Roscoe. He wanted me to. And I might have. I might have. God in mercy, I might have. Oh. Damn you! Damn you!
He was crying then.
There wasn't any sound. It was past the point where the puny sound of a human voice can make any difference. After Roy chopped off his last finger with the axe, nothing happened to the good nose till almost two decades of slow days passed. Days that must have seemed as cruel as stillbirth. The pointlessness, the sameness. I believe even the Great Depression, when it came along in the 30s, must have seemed like just more of the same to them. Stopped going into town to sell eggs and sour cream. So it only surprises me that Roy didn't start it on his toes the same way. Chopped his 10 toes off. 9 of them all at once, and the last one in the barn with an axe. Make Lyman bring the damn things in and dump them in the bean bowl. And Edith there. Edith never went out driving with my dad again. Something bright went out of her brown eyes. She stopped talking to Roy. Well, she took care of him. She'd button his shirt, mash his potatoes, cut his meat into bites, she tied his shoes. But she paid no attention to anything he had to say. Quiet kitchen. Just Roy's orders and Lyman's pass the pepper, or ain't there any more gravy? But finally, it must have got to be dead silence. So 20 years passed. My father married the widow Newcomb, whose first husband went down to the cellar and hanged himself with a cotton rope, August 1920. My mother knew how to get what she wanted. Anyway, they were married in the fall of 1925. Widow Newcomb was 32, my dad was 35. 3 years later, March 9th, 1928, I came along. Of course, my mother wouldn't pay any notice to the good nose down the road. At that time, I was the only one that saw much of the good nose. When I was 6 or 7, I'd start walking the half mile to the good nose place to help Edith hoe the garden or gather eggs. She always had a pack of gum in the pocket of her apron, and she'd give me a stick. She'd take one herself, and we'd chew our gum while we gathered eggs. Although I couldn't trust some of these red chickens squirting their shiny green chicken squirt neat as a dog. Then suddenly, it was the 1930s. The madman Hitler loose in Germany. And there was talk about war and talk about taking action. I suppose it was all this talk about doing something that made it possible for Lyman.
On Saturday nights, I would go over to Holt's Tavern.
Lyman was age 41, still a boy. Farm boy with hot sweat running down into his pants. He turns up and he don't know what to do with himself.
Wenzel Gertz would call out, "Gloria, two beers." So Gloria, the waitress, brought the beers over, and Wenzel gave me one, and I drank my glass without tasting it, just throwing it down quick like cod liver oil.
Then Lyman drank three more, or four more. Barry Barnes, the best poker player in Holt County, he studies Lyman's eyes and he says, "Boys, I believe Lyman's ready. Deal him in." And they proceed to play. They was playing for money and nickel ante with a dime bump.
Wenzel tried to explain the game to me, but I had to keep asking things like, how come three deuces is better than four cards, even when the four cards is two aces and two kings?
So Harry Barnes finally wrote it down for him on one of those barroom napkins, all that poker knowledge down there in black ink on a napkin. I tell somebody that never didn't even play poker before, someone as green as lime and is bound to win, if you can just get Harry Barnes to write it all down on a whole tavern napkin. Then Lyman stood up in the middle of the hand and walked over to Gloria. He just stood there in that yellow tie and black Sunday suit, his eyes turned to glass marbles. He didn't seem to know what to do with himself, so Gloria, she put her bar tray down. She showed him where to put his hands, one on her waist, the other in her hand. They began to dance. She pressed in along him, and he put both his middle-aged bachelor arms around her so that his Sunday shirt cuffs showed through and bright against her black waitress outfit. His hands rode snug above her buttocks.
And the dance band started up, and we shuffled around, and she patted me on the head and tickled a finger in my ear, and she winked at all the other people in the tavern. I was enjoying myself, having invented my life.
All I know is that after that last song, he tells Gloria, it's late, it's almost 11, I gotta leave. Well, Gloria, she just laughed and turned to Wenzel and said, ain't he cute? Well, I don't know if Lyman Goodenough was ever in his life what you might call cute. At least by 1940 he was not. What I think happened was Lyman must have known, despite the beer, that once he got home there was going to be hell to pay. There sat Lyman, his head pounding, his mouth tasting like something that resembled pig slop, listening to Roy say, so you ain't learned yet. You ain't learned that if you're ever going to mount to anything, you can't stay out all Saturday night diddling. In the following year, on Sunday morning in December 1941, something happened that changed it all. Pearl Harbor, hell of a big tragedy for most Americans, was for Lyman what he'd been waiting for. Pearl Harbor was his ticket out. In the middle of the night, late in December, Lyman was standing at the station. The strings of his cap were pulled down tight in a double bow under his chin, which pulled the bill of his cap down low on his forehead. He was standing there holding his suitcase. Lyman's shoes were his best, the black polished ones he must have worn to the whole tavern. My dad had taken Lyman to the station. He said, I don't suppose you thought to tell Edith you were leaving.
She knows. She packed me some sandwiches. I got them right here with me. Edith says for at least one of us to get away. And I'm going to write her about it. Edith says for me to see all the sights I can and taste pleasure.
Then in his long overcoat and best shoes, Lyman boarded the train, and that was the last anyone in Hope County saw of him for almost 20 years, including Edith.
The train went to Denver, but I didn't get off. I didn't get off in Cheyenne either, or Salt Lake. Not until Los Angeles. I hired on to work in a Los Angeles airplane factory. I worked a daily shift, pulling levers, grinding gears, not talking much. I listened to the welders.
And all the time, he was waiting for MacArthur to sign those surrender papers, saving his money, saving to buy his first Pontiac automobile. Then he took off again.
I saw the sights and tasted pleasure.
I suspect he paid rent at a succession of cheap rooms. He pushed cement up construction ramps. He drank beer in dark bars with chipped mirrors. And sometimes he followed the big hips of an aging barmaid up the stairs to his own rented room. He bought more Pontiacs. He kept moving, seeing what there was of Boise or Omaha worth seeing, and taking off and driving to Dubuque, or Oklahoma, or Memphis.
He sent me picture postcards with color likenesses on them, and at Christmas time, a package of $20 bills tied with a ribbon.
Lyman never sent himself home. He didn't come home when Roy finally died in 1952. Maybe he didn't know. Edith would have had to send word to the last address on the last picture postcard.
He never left a forwarding address, just general delivery.
Then again, maybe he was afraid to come back. Maybe he thought you couldn't be real sure the old son of a bitch was really dead. Even when you saw him standing there in front of his coffin, lying there like a slab of mean yellow granite, his eyes closed, his red stumps sticking out beneath his white shirt cuffs. Lyman stayed away for 9 years more after the old man was buried out beside Otis Murray's cornfield.
I stayed home. I didn't even drive those 7 miles into Holt very often.
Edith was 55 when Roy died in 1952. She was 64 when Lyman finally returned in 1961. That amounts to a lifetime of staying home.
I milked the cows, separated milk, cooked meals, still cutting Daddy's meat bites, filling the buttonholes of his shirt with buttons. Sometimes I belted him onto the tractor. I would drive, clutching tight to the wheel, making the furrows behind me as straight as I could. He rode beside me, waving his arms, pointing those blunt stumps past my head.
And one day, driving in the truck with my dad, we saw them. Saturday morning, early, bright out in the field, there was that damn John Deere tractor with two heads sticking up behind the exhaust stack. My father, I braked at the side of the road. My father got out, stepped over the fence, and stood there waiting in the stubble on the exact ground that the tractor would have to go on before it would turn back. The tractor came on. You could see Edith's straw hat and the old man's face, his stumps ruining the air. The tractor came on, and I thought, Jesus, at least her feet can touch the brake pedal. At least by now she knows how to turn the steering wheel, doesn't she? My dad didn't move. Edith got the tractor stopped a foot in front of him. I don't know why. I ripped it off, and the tractor coughed and died. And the old man was flat rage and spit, screaming murder, flailing his stumps, windmill fashion, till blood showed red. He was hitting at the belt, the leather contraption that held him in place, and Edith just bent her head, reached past him, and unbuckled the damn thing, and the old man fell to the ground, came running at my dad and hit him in the throat. My dad grabbed him by the shirt and held him at eye level and flung him to the ground. And the old man came again, flailing, and my dad hit him with his weight on the point of his chin, and the old man went down. There was blue swelling, and the old man looked at my dad with watery eyes and said, "Get him out of here! This is my land!" My father said, "Don't worry, I'm leaving." He bent over the old man and he said, "But don't you ever put her on that tractor again, you hear me? Next time," he said, "I'll kill you! I'll kill you!" My dad washed himself off of the horse tank, got behind the wheel of the pickup, Saturday morning, 1943. He said to me, "Son, you ever drank beer before?" "No, sir," I said. "Well," he said, "it's time you start." After that, we all just settled into our ruts again. Sometimes, looking at this story, it seems to me that's all it is. A series of ruts. Some of them lasting 4 or 5 years, some 20. After that Saturday morning, the old bastard, Roy Goodenough, wouldn't say a piddling word.
I had to guess what he wanted. And if I didn't always guess right, then he would stump shove his bowl of mush off the kitchen table.
Or he'd piss his pants out of meanness while she watched.
From first spring until late fall, I fed him quick and took him outside to sit in the car alone where he could watch Charlie Best make slow progress in our hayfield.
I am in Mobile now. I am in Montgomery. I am in Baltimore.
I collected Lyman's cards and the bow-tied $20 bills from Christmas in separate boxes in the dresser drawer. I pinned the postcards, picture side out, on the walls of the living room. I showed Roy a picture of a glass building or some photograph of Robert E. Lee riding atop a marble horse. And well, Roy seemed to confuse Robert E. Lee with Lyman. Or, occasionally, he did seem to recall just who Lyman was, but it only made him mad. He would spit on the floor, wet the front seat of the car. I stopped showing him the postcards.
Then, like Lyman, I left. I went to college at A&M in Fort Collins for a while. I got my first solid lesson, June 11th, 1950. My dad and I were on horseback, driving cattle in naked sandhill grass. The grass was thick, green, tall, spotted with wildflowers. I was riding one part of the pasture, my dad the other. At the horse tank, I got him shut up, but Dad wasn't in yet. So I rode out to help him. I found his horse in the pasture chewing on native grass. Dad was 40 feet away, lying on his face in the sand. I turned him over. His face was bluish, mad shock. His eyes were wide open. He was dead. His hands clutched hard at his chest, clutching at his shirt. There were deep, wet ruts in the sand where it looked like he'd been trying to kick something away from him, like maybe it was a snake or a rabid dog. Brushed the sand out of his brown eyes. I sat next to the length of his body, and I just cried. I didn't even know how to cry for him. I sat there fanning him, waiting for the force to get up and move him, gather him up, take him home. At the funeral, several people came up to me, shook my hand, and said, at least he died doing something he enjoyed. Then it was only Edith there beside me, beside the box lowered into the hole, and the stone, John Roscoe, February 24th, 1890, June 11th, 1950. There was a little bit of breeze and the leaves turned and washed. Edith had been crying. I could see that her face had gone to pieces.
He asked me to marry him. Did you know that?
Yes, he told me.
But I couldn't. You understand, don't you, Sandy? I couldn't.
She was crying again, for the last time I have known her to cry. There wasn't much sound to it. There was one other thing that happened 2 years later, 1952. It must have been October.
I went into Roy's bedroom that morning to dress him for the day in his overalls. He was rigid as stone. His mouth was locked open like a piece of box iron.
I wasn't surprised when she called me. Since the death of my dad, I'd been checking in on her once a week, stopping by the house early in the evening. Edith and I would sit on the porch swing visiting barn swallows, hunting bugs, and the locusts singing in the elm trees.
I made all the funeral arrangements. I buried Roy Goodnow in town, in the plot west of my mother Ada. He had blocked my mother's view of the east while she lived. He wasn't about to do that when she was dead.
Well, then Edith was completely alone. Not just for an afternoon or a month, but for 1 year after another, for 10 years more. Making herself cook 3 meals a day, playing the radio so there'd be some human voice in the house, getting up to silence, going to bed in silence.
You forget how to string words together. You can't recall the true weight of words.
So there got to be stories about her, about how she was turning crazy out here all alone, how she was starving to death on tea and toast, how she slept in the barn, how she was partial to Elvis Presley. Lightning disappeared. Townspeople said she was taken with the stars. They'd find her out on the roads late at night, stargazing.
I just busied myself with those picture postcards. I straight pinned them in rows on the walls of the living room so I could trace Lyman's progress yearly for 20 years across the country, starting in the West and then the Middle West and Deep South and finally the East. To me, the pictures on the cards were like bright surface things. Glass skyscrapers, blue fountains, statues, city parks with pruned trees and green park benches. Norway's, on the backs of the cards, in Lyman's scribble, a message.
Dear sis, how are you? I am in Cleveland. Boy, it's hot. Love, your brother, Lyman.
I think she was convinced that at least he was seeing some of this country's sights, broadening himself, and so when he finally did return, some of the world would rub off on her.
Did I tell you Lyman's in Pittsburgh? Yes, yes, I believe he's doing well. Here, look in the shoebox, open it.
And there were all those packets of unused, unspent dollar bills, all of them 20s, all of them wrapped in red bows. I doubt she even counted them. Instead, those damn bundles of green stuff seemed to be something more to her, just because they'd been tied, stamped, and mailed by Lyman's hand.
Yes. When he gets back, we will take some trips.
But that might not happen, either.
Well, of course he'll come back. Well, there wouldn't be any point if he didn't come back, now would there?
I felt so damn sorry for her. She had lost so much of her life to waiting. Waiting on a damn mush-minded permanent escapee, her brother. Remember, I put my arm around her. She was thin and fragile. I remember we sat together for a moment on the couch. She put her head on my shoulder. I remember I kissed the top of her head. I remember that when I went back to visit and entered that postcard living room again, she seemed fine, pleasant, a little vacant, as if she was still caught in that fog dream of hers. And toward the end of July 1961, she called.
Good, you're home. I have a surprise for you. Will you come for supper?
I cleaned up, combed my hair, and drove to the Goodenough place. There, parked in front of the house, was a new green Pontiac without a seat plate. Inside the house, his elbows on the kitchen table and a foolish lapdog grin on his face, was Lyman Goodenough.
Long time no see.
He had been gone 20 years, and he was a sight. He was draped fancy in a new houndstooth suit. It was too hot and too heavy for July. On his feet, he sported black and white wingtips that any Las Vegas gambler or East Colfax pimp in Denver would have thought twice. Edith was beaming, her face like a fresh pink poppy. She was festive, worrying if Lyman had enough roast beef and sweet potatoes. Meanwhile, Lyman masticated and talked with his mouth full.
Now, sir, you take Los Angeles, California. It's bigger than you can believe. Now, Mobile, Alabama ain't so big. It is hot, hot, hot. You can keep New York City. Now, yes, sirree, you can keep New York City.
We had our cherry pie, and Lyman had talked himself full circle home again when he wanted me to see his Pontiac that stood purple-green under the yard light. One of those long, heavy boat cars they made in the 60s with chrome.
Well, she drives like a wet dream. Yeah, almost got 11,000 miles on her.
Sure, all right, but Lyman, why in goddamn hell, what took you so long? Didn't you realize she was waiting all this time?
Who?
Edith, for Christ's sake, your sister!
Oh, well, there's a lot of cities, Sandy. You just don't have any idea.
And you had to see every damn one of them, is that it?
No, sir, no. I skipped a few.
Lyman stood in the yard light, flicking the dead grasshoppers and dead millers off the chrome of the grill.
You suppose she's got any more cherry pie? That's one thing I miss.
I helped Lyman carry his miserable, beat-up metal and cardboard suitcases into the house. He spread them out on the living room floor like he imagined himself to be some kind of Marco Polo returned from outer Mongolia. In truth, it was all junk. An old bachelor's collection of tourist trinkets. That didn't matter to Edith. He gave her a scarf from Boise, Idaho, a heavy bracelet from the Omaha stockyards, a silver necklace affair from which dangled a pendant in the form of Georgia peach.
And this here is for you, Sandy. A shoehorn from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, with the name of the shoe store scratched on the tin handle.
By the time he was finished, Edith was weighted down with cheap necklaces, purple scarves, dangling bracelets, all of them with city names on them. Andrew explained each postcard on the wall. Each one reminded him of something, and he recalled it for us in droning detail. The days and months he'd spent in each place. Edith was as attentive as a lover.
Now, Lyman, there's something more I want to show you.
Can't we have some cherry pie first?
She went to the bureau and came back with the shoebox, the one with the unspent, never even counted $20 bills wrapped in bows.
Yours. Ours now. $2,700.
You never spent a one.
No.
Look here, Sandy. She never spent the money.
Edith tried to keep me there for more cherry pie, but I was full of everything. From my pickup, I turned to look back at them waving in the doorway, a balding man in a winter suit, and a beautiful lady with shining eyes. Now, I suppose you could say that what happened to them was like they were kids, having a second childhood. Edith learned to drink gimlets from a goblet. Lyman refused to change his clothes and went on dressing like a banker in wingtips, dress pants, shirt and tie. They put Miles on the Pontiac. Why, hell, they even started to drive into Holt for the dance at the Holt Legion on Saturday nights, rising when Shorty Stovall struck up the Tennessee Waltz, and then sliding around the room in a kind of funereal two-step, her hand on the padded shoulder of his houndstooth suit coat. And they drove to Denver, went to Elitch's amusement park, toured Estes Park, had trout dinner at the Broadmoor Hotel in Colorado Springs. And you understand, before this time, Edith hadn't seen anything of life beyond the Holt County border. Now, don't pretend to think that 6 years is anywhere near enough time, 1961 to 1967, but I suppose if that's all you're given, 6 years will have to do. In the end, that's what Edith Goodenough had. 6 years of good times. Then in the summer of 1963, I married my wife, Mavis. I had been waiting for Mavis to pop the question. We had some good times in our 13 years together. She would no doubt tell you that I'm too bullheaded, that I don't think logically. From my side, I might wish occasionally she had a sense of humor. Mavis worked as a nurse at the hospital. I ranched and farmed, cultivated corn, cut calves. After supper, we'd have the Goodenoughs over to play rook, or we'd go to their place a couple times a month. Edith and Mavis got to be good friends.
In August of 1967, we all went to the county fair. We saw the exhibits in the home ec building, quilts on display, artwork, flower arrangements, and pickles. Marvella Packwood won the bread and butter pickle ribbon again.
I like to tease Mavis. Looks like a good jar of pickles to me. Look at that car. I probably ought to have married Marvella. I always did fancy bread and butter pickles with my dinner tea, didn't you, Lyman?
I couldn't get any, not where I've been. New York, never heard of them.
We watched the hog judging. One of the pigs pissed on the judge's alligator boots, and the 4-H kid that owned it started kicking sawdust on the mess and looking in the judge's eyes for some sign of mercy, some sign of humor, but judges don't have a sense of humor. The pig with the empty bladder didn't win the thing.
We went to the rodeo. The guys and girls galloped their horses in figure eights. The loudspeakers blared the national anthem, and the cowboys held their hats.
There was this long-necked, goosey kid from Valentine, Nebraska, stayed on his saddle rock the full 8 seconds, but the kid got racing so fast, he flew headfirst over his horse's neck.
Mavis and I bet on the quarter horse races, using a system the men did not understand.
Before we could drive home, we had to do the carnival.
Throwing darts for stuffed monkeys.
Licking cotton candy off our fingers. Play bingo.
Tossing nickels.
Drinking more beer.
And ride the Ferris wheel. The colored lights were on all over the carnival, and the loudspeakers were now playing some scratchy rock and roll music.
From the top, we could see far out over the fairgrounds. grandstand in the buildings,
and to the arena, to the bucking chutes where the bucking dogs were grazing in the valley.
Lyman and Edith were in the seat in front of Mavis and me. Of all the things that day, I remember the Ferris wheel best. It's the picture I hold in my mind when I think of that period of their lives. As we came down around the back side of the wheel, we could see them below us, rocking a little, the flickering colored lights, music playing, his hand tapping time on her bare arm. I hold that picture in my mind. What happened next, none of us wanted. It happened and it's over with. Come August, it will be 10 years. On the highway south of Holt, there's a small bridge called the 5 Mile Bridge. No creek or water runs under it, just a weed-filled wash that fills with water one day in late spring. People use it as a landmark. It has been the site of 2 accidents. That night, coming home in Lyman's Pontiac, Lyman was driving, Mavis asleep in the back seat, Edith in front, dozing next to Lyman. I was half asleep myself, looking at the month-old wheat stubble, the bright shining corn beyond the fence.
We bounced off the near side of the Iron Bridge rail.
Shooting across to the other side, we caught the far end of the bridge.
The car spun, went back over to the right side of the road.
Cleared the bridge and dove, nose first, onto the roadside.
Slammed into the bank of the barrow ditch, rocked back, jolted onto its top.
We were thrown upside down. There were sharp edges, cutting glass everywhere, the bad smell of gasoline and the sound of something dripping.
Lyman was out cold. Edith moaning in shock. Mavis's face was turned away from me. The back window had been smashed free of glass. I kicked off some jagged edges and crawled out into the ditch. I got Mavis out, and then Edith and Lyman after her out the back window into the ditch. I could see figures in the light coming down from the road. It was Ed Taylor and his friend. Ed drove us into town. Then there was the feeling afterward. Lyman in traction in the hospital. Mavis still calm, in pain. Edith with her arm in a white cast, me with stitches where the glass had cut my face. In the years that followed, we watched Lyman become a child. It didn't happen right away. It took almost 10 years. But one thing, his car was gone. They totaled Pontiac. Bernie's wrecking service wrenched it up out of the ditch weed and towed it into town without salvaging even the tires. It's still there in the junkyard west of the city's water treatment ponds, standing in the middle of a weedy lot, the hood propped open.
It was close to Halloween before Doc Schmidt released Lyman from the hospital.
He looked like maybe the nurses had gotten him up to go trick-or-treating. Around his neck, he was still wearing that padded horse collar affair. His face had green and yellow bruises. Well, he just seemed shrunken, old, brittle, confused.
The sun hurt his eyes. We put him on the couch in the living room where the postcards he sent during the 20 years of travel were pinned in neat rows. He was crotchety. His toast was cold. His shoestring was missing its plastic end. His sock had a hole. I would find him in the living room staring vacantly at those postcards. He still dressed himself every morning in suit pants and dress shirt with a bow tie, but clothes seemed to hang on him.
Towards the end, he was using 2 canes. I believe Edith was relieved when Lyman said he wouldn't drive anymore. Mavis and I drove them to the store every week, and every 6 months to Doc Schmidt. And when Doc Schmidt retired, Lyman decided he'd had enough of doctors. He wasn't ever going to another one. He refused to step outside the house for any reason. He wouldn't leave the house.
He was too busy traveling in the parlor. Lyman began to retrace his transcontinental trip. He sent off to Los Angeles and Boise and Omaha and Mobile and Cleveland for brochures and for Chamber of Commerce pamphlets and bus schedules and train routes.
Without leaving the house, Lyman was traveling. He had his own travel bureau established in the parlor with boxes, maps, and desks.
I can tell what train to take from Boston to Chicago, what connection to make, what there is to see in the Windy City once you get there, where to stay.
But Lyman was not going. He had limited his world to a space 20 feet square on the west end of the house.
He sat there every day beside a lamp, poring like a travel clerk over the road maps and the glossy city flyers. To protect his eyes, I bought him a green visor.
He wore it loose on his head, propped on his old man's hair-filled ears. And Edith was getting tired. She seemed to have to catch her breath after any kind of movement, sweeping the floor, feeding the chickens. She was wearing thin as water.
Lyman's mind was closing down. There were times when he couldn't make his travel arrangements come out right. I would leave the dishes to soak or the peas to burn to help him. He was sending himself on imaginary trips to Memphis and Mobile. He would spend half the night working on travel charts.
I think it would be better to move the bedroom furniture downstairs, set it up in the living room next to the parlor so you don't have to climb stairs. That was the day I realized for the first time that there was only one bedroom upstairs with a double bed, an old-fashioned quilt. We stood there facing each other in the room where Edith had been born, where Lyman had been born 2 years later, where Ada had died, where the old man had died with his mouth locked open like bauxite. There's a lot of history to be worried about whether they slept in the same bed. Lyman was busy in the parlor looking at the road map. Where are you headed today, Lyman? New York City.
Salt Lake.
Hell of a place, Salt Lake. And I'll say this. You can make what you want of the good-nosed bedroom arrangement. Stir it according to your own light. Myself, I don't make anything of it. They wanted to sleep in the same bed, warm their feet under the same patchwork, old-fashioned quilt like they had when they were kids, before this century even began. Well, that was their business. Because when you know people all your life, you try to understand how it is for them. And when you can't understand, you just accept.
For days, Lyman's mind would be just about as good as it had been. He managed to function in the parlor with his brochures, but then, for no reason, he'd be gone. For half a day, he'd babble from his bed about nothing. He spent one entire afternoon talking about nettles.
He was still trying to travel. And when things didn't connect right, he could turn violent. He used those canes of his.
And then, in March of last year, we acquired an old milk-eyed dog by default.
And Lyman reached the edge.
It was an old black and brown dog with mottled white on its belly, a mixture of border collie and spaniel. Some town folks must have dropped her off. I called her Nancy. I brought her into the house. Her eyes were milky with cataracts. She slept a lot and whimpered when she wasn't sleeping.
And that's when the trouble started with Lyman. He was jealous of the damn thing. It was like he felt his sister was caring for something that wasn't him. If Edith wasn't looking, he'd give the dog a boot. Then one late winter, early spring afternoon last March, I was at the Goodnose working on the tractor I kept stored out of the weather in the machine shop. And Edith was calling me.
Sandy, you better come inside. You better come now.
Inside the house, I found Edith sitting in a chair. Lyman was standing in the parlor as if he'd fight anyone. He looked wild. The travel clerk's visor of his was tilted lopsided on his head, and his eyes looked flat. Insane bughouse. The dog Nancy was in the corner on her rug. Will you tell me what happened, Edith? Tell me what happened.
We were in the parlor, with the travel boxes spread out, the maps on the wall. Lyman had decided, it being late winter in Colorado, that we would take in the sun in Phoenix. He said,
we will have to get on in Denver, go north to Cheyenne, cross over to Salt Lake, track west to San Francisco, change trains for Los Angeles, and then come back eastward into Arizona.
And then Lyman couldn't manage it. It called for more sense, more figuring and understanding of time changes and layovers than he was capable of. It set him off. And then Nancy wandered in.
Get that damn thing out of here. She don't belong here with us. She stinks. Get her out.
She was kneeling in front of the dog, talking to her, patting her head, when Lyman hit Nancy on the spine with his cane. There was a sharp bark, a yell.
Oh, Jesus! Get her. I can't get rid of her.
Nancy managed a kind of waddling gallop into the kitchen. She was cringing and whimpering beside the stove, and I looked up, and Lyman was crazy. His eyes, like new copper, red and insane. He was flailing his cane around the room, hitting anything, the desk, the boxes, the lamp. And before I could get out of the way, he hit me on the arms and back.
Edith was staring at the closed door. Her face was colorless, pained. Her gray hair had become dislodged from its knot.
He just can't help what he does.
I know it.
I won't have him strapped down to a hospital bed or whatever they do now, sedate him with pills and shots to make him sleep all the time. I couldn't stand that. And he's mine to take care of. He's mine to take care of.
In the next few months, Lyman stopped playing travel. Edith took care of him with patience and kindness and, yes, with love. Although you'd have to see that for yourself, I don't know how to tell you about it. All I know how to tell you is that sometime between March and December, Edith Goodenough decided by herself what to do with her brother. Edith made up her own mind. It was a solitary decision.
I woke that morning later than I wanted. There was already more than enough light in the living room for me to see Lyman clearly. Over against the opposite wall in his cast iron bed with the yellowing postcards pinned to the wallpaper walls above him. I got dressed, started the dishes, started the coffee, and then I woke Lyman. We ate breakfast of poached eggs, buttered toast. Lyman shaved himself in the bathroom. I found him there, studying himself in the mirror. He had cut his neck along the folds of loose skin. He was amused by the trickle of blood dripping onto the whiskers. He staunched it with toilet paper. I cleaned him up and got him dressed in his white shirt, dress pants, and slippers, and I set him down in a chair under the lamp in the parlor so he could look at pictures. A National Geographic magazine with colored pictures of Eskimos and marine life and wide-hipped Hawaiian women dancing. Are you enjoying the pictures, Lyman?
They got a lot of pictures.
Yes, I saved them for you. So the morning passed quietly. I made a pie, rolled the thin crust out on the counter the way my mother had showed me 70 years before. I filled it with pumpkin batter. I was well pleased with the result. Pumpkin was Lyman's favorite, though I suppose everything must have tasted like oatmeal mush to him. By this time. Then I made lunch. Lyman was not at all hungry. Stooped over his bowl of tomato soup, he played with his spoon, stirring the red stuff around in the bowl. He was tired, wilted, glass-eyed. I knew he was ready to lie down on his bed, but I couldn't permit it. I needed him to stay up. Lyman, you can look at your postcards.
I haven't got no postcards.
Well, of course you do. Why, the ones that you sent me when you were gone all those years. I went over to the wall and untapped the first postcard you sent me from California, December 1941. You see what it says up here on the corner? Los Angeles, California. And on the other side, this is what you wrote. Dear Sis, well, I made it out here. Now they all say I'm not right for soldiers. So I have a job in an airplane factory. Beats farming anyhow. Love, your brother, Lyman.
I wrote that?
Yes, that's right. You do remember, don't you?
Give it to me. It's mine.
Gave it to him. To hold. Turn over in his old farm boy's hands to peer at and turn over. He sat in his stuffed chair and I removed the remaining postcards from the walls. He was semi-alert. I knew I would have to move up my plans by an hour. A month ago, I had decided on turkey for supper, but There were going to be too many leftovers, and besides, chicken was turkey, salami. So I stuffed the chicken with its legs secure and put it into bake. I peeled potatoes and got out a canned jar of beans. Chicken, potatoes, green beans, and afterwards, pumpkin pie. It would make a satisfactory meal. It would conclude with a satisfactory meal. I permitted myself a short nap. And then I heard Sanders Roscoe's wife Mavis drive in the driveway, bringing me some cream from the store. I gave her pumpkin pie. I wished her season's greetings. I knew it would be for the last time. I accepted that. I took the dog outside again. Nancy didn't want to go. I had to force her, take her by the collar. I tied her to the latch in the open doorway with a length of rope with enough food and water to last a day or two. I left food for the red chickens. I dragged the bag of chicken feet into the center of the dirt floor and cut it open so they too would survive. It was then, walking back to the house under that late purpling sky, I understood. I knew it then. I ironed Lyman's shirt, pressed it clean on the ironing board so that he would appear gentlemanly. I took it into him. He was fumbling with faded postcards of Memphis and Mobile, New York and Boise. I persuaded him to change his shirt. Then I changed my clothes. I put on a fine dark skirt and pink blouse. I brushed my hair. And then we went together and sat to supper in the kitchen, looking, I believe, as if we were contented. It was enough to be dressed up, red candles flickering, enjoying a satisfactory supper. I'm glad you came home. I know you don't understand, but I'm glad you came home when you did. Can you remember all we've done?
I'm too tired.
Would you like to lie down?
I want to sleep.
Yes. It's been a long day. Come on then, I'll help you up. I lifted up under his arm. I put him down to bed in his suit clothes. I pulled the blanket up over his long and quiet body. The blue veins and age spots showed dimly in the fading light. I put my hand on his forehead once. I bent and kissed him. And then I went into the kitchen and I put out the candles with moistened fingers. I locked the back porch door. I went into the living room and I locked the door that opened into the front of the house. I sat down in the rocking chair. I watched the dark collect in the room. I knew that in a moment I would rise and strike a match to the old yellowing, dust-covered papers in the stairway. But that moment hadn't come yet. I was content to sit and rock quietly. I had the matches in my lap. I looked out past Lyman out that south window and saw the elm trees, their branches bare and clean and dark against the sky. I waited. In a moment, I'll stand up soon. Soon I'll stand up.
It was a dog barking. Something as simple and ordinary and unpredictable as that, that's all it was. A loud, persistent barking, our dog Jack, his nose raised into the night. Out the window I saw the smoke, I rushed in my pickup to the Goodenough house, seeing bright flames through the windows, the fire burning the old dry wallpaper in the empty bedrooms. There was yellow smoke rising. The whole place was lit up in a strange flickering light that made the trees and fence seem to waltz on the brown grass. I ran to the porch. The door was locked. They never locked their doors. What the hell was this? I was going to kick in a window, the south window to the living room, smash it in, get in that way. And then I saw Edith. Beyond the window, Edith was sitting in the rocking chair looking at me. She sat bolt upright, staring at me as if I startled her. I could see her eyes, her face, her white hair. And then, as I stood peering through the window, she did something I will never forget. Something which stopped me from breaking that window. And which, if you think about it, has altered everything else. Edith raised her hand from the arm of that rocking chair. That's all she did, but do you understand what I'm saying? She lifted one pale, blue-veined hand to warn me, to stop me. She was telling me to stay away. She didn't want my help. She desired that I do nothing. Just then I realized that. I realized why the doors were locked. It all came together for me on that side porch. Edith relaxed back into the rocker. She lowered her hand, shut her eyes. Lyman was asleep just below me, facing the window, his bow tie dark against the white of his best white suit. So I stood there. I could hear the neighbors coming into the yard. You can think what you want to. Maybe you would have been able to break that window and haul those two out into the yard. I couldn't. I didn't. I had seen Edith Goodenough raise her hand. Then I heard them all coming, the neighbors and Bud Seeley, and I watched as Edith and Lyman were carried out of the house wrapped in blankets, down the steps to the ambulance. They were both unconscious, their arms dangling loose like rags. The neighbors soaked the well house and outbuildings with their hoses, but the house burnt down to its limestone foundations. When the roof caved in, the sparks exploded into the sky like fireworks. One time in the night, Lyman died. After his pumpkin pie with a dollop of whipped cream, Lyman just went off to sleep and never woke up again. They said it was smoke inhalation. They said it was not possible to save him. And I was one of the pallbearers 2 days later when we lowered him into the frozen ground beside his mother. There would be just that much distance, the width of his mother's grave between him and the old stump-armed man. Edith was still in the IC unit, that damn tube shoved up her nose, unconscious. Edith just hung on and hung on like she didn't know how to let go. That was in December. It's April now. She's getting better. I'm afraid Bud Seeley and those imported lawyers will drive her over to the courthouse after all and make her endure a trial for what they will insist is murder. Not one son of a bitch amongst them who understands a goddamn thing. Well, I'm done talking now. I've told you all I know. Only before you leave, before you see that it's full dark, you still have time to drive that half mile east and see what remains of that yellow house. Poking around, you might find some charred travel brochures or a cracked plate or two. Then if you have time, you can drive into town and notice Lyman's last green Pontiac rusting in the old junkyard. Or drive on out to the cemetery where you'll find the three Goodenough headstones over there at the far end across the fence from Otis Murray's cornfield. You go ahead and do all that, but I can't go with you. I'm going back to the hospital to visit a beautiful white-haired woman who will be 80 years old on Thursday. and who is still, in all the ways that matter, just as fine and beautiful as she must have been in 1922 when she was 25 and went out riding in the sand hills in a Model T with my dad. Windows rolled down, night air blowing fresh, and Lyman Goodenough riding in the back seat.